water in your eyes. That God is always loving. When anger grows like it does, and respect can get discarded, every day that we wait, something good is dying. Where we come and depart, even when we go, even we go too far, love is an art at all. Can we open our hearts? Drop our defenses. We gotta find it. Give one of us.
To your journey's end. count out your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God has done. Why don't you count your blessings?
Hallelujah. Thank you, God. God, you are everlasting, and we look to you. You are the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. God, we acknowledge your goodness and your greatness, your everlastingness, your eternalness, even right now, oh Lord. Thank you for clearing up whatever is happening in the live stream, God, so that your worship and this experience we want to have together would flow freely. We trust you, oh Lord. And even after all these weeks, every Sunday is like the first Sunday. And so we thank you for the opportunity to see you move anew and afresh. We thank you for granting us the privilege to trust you one more time, for reminding us that we don't do anything on our own, but we need you for everything. And in everything, we give you thanks. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Amen and amen. Amen, amen, amen. I don't know, we've been doing this for about 7-8 months, and we're still dealing with please be ready if you have not already prepared yourself, because it is First Sunday. Well, I want to start again by simply saying happy birthday to all of you who are celebrating birthdays this week. And God bless you. We are grateful to the Lord for your life. I think this for the second week in a row, we did not have any anniversaries, wedding anniversaries, but we do have birth anniversaries. And so God bless you. May this new year of your life be your very best yet. May you feel and sense God's power and God's peace and God's strength with you. There are several members actually whose birthdays are today. And so happy birthday. God bless you. We love you. I also want to welcome not only our members and those celebrating birthdays, but if you are visiting with us, we want to say welcome to our church. And again, let you know that you can find out more information about us by going to our website. If this is your first time, or if you've been visiting for a few times and you haven't done so, you can go to our website website and click the contact page, and you can fill out a welcome card, and we will reach out to you, send you an email. If you have specific prayer requests, you can do it that way. You can also share your prayer requests and praise reports right there in the comment section of the stream, wherever you're watching service this morning. But we want you to know that we don't think it's an accident or coincidental that you are worshiping with us, even virtually. There's so many options, and it's so easy to simply click away from a worship service. And so we believe that if you're here with us consistently, or this is your first time, it's because the Lord wants you to be here to experience worship and to have this word. I want to let you know that today, this afternoon, we will be wrapping up our staff and leadership appreciation receiving of cards. I'll be here at 2 o'clock, from 2 to 3 this afternoon. All you have to do is just pull up right outside and you can leave your cards in. I have a bucket there. You can just drop them into. You don't have to get out of the car. It's raining now, but look at the forecast. I believe the rain will pass even before we get out of service. And so if you still have cards that you have written for our staff and our leaders to appreciate them, will you please drop those off with me today? And don't forget, your other option is that you may go ahead and mail those to us. And then what we will be doing over the next several weeks is distributing those cards that you have taken the time to write to our leaders and our staff. And it's going to give them great joy and delight to read your words of appreciation and love and gratitude. So thank you for being generous with your time. And thank you for just simply being kind-hearted by sharing your gratitude for our staff and our leaders. I also want to remind you that today is the first Sunday of November. There are, I believe, 5 Sundays in the month of November since we're starting on the 1st. And so this afternoon, directly after service at 12:30, we will have our first Sunday fellowship. The first Sunday fellowship on WebEx. And so you can go there and you can check that out. It'll be a group of members. And that's a way for us to be able to interact with one another. Of course, you all are interacting in the chat, but some of you, you can't see each other's faces. And so this is just something we're setting aside for every first Sunday so that we can be together and interact. And we know that we have a very important election coming up on this Tuesday. And I'm hearing, and I'm sure you're hearing, a lot of trepidation, and there's some concerns about what's happening and how people are going to respond. And so first of all, I want to encourage you to vote if you haven't done so already. It's very important that you do so. Early voting, I believe, is still going on in all 3 jurisdictions here in the DMV. And then, of course, some of you are like me. You're just going to go to the polls on Tuesday. And I just decided I'd just stand in line and go that day. And so let's make sure that we pray for peace, that we pray for wisdom, that we pray for grace as a nation. I was hearing that in D.C. and maybe even in some other jurisdictions that they're boarding up buildings, concerned about the aftermath. And people have been, just doing things that are just not really good and safe in terms of trying to promote their candidate. And so we really need to be prayerful. Everyone should be able to exercise their right to vote freely without any threat and without any suppression. And we know that some of those things are real. But please don't take this opportunity lightly to go and to vote on Tuesday afternoon or Tuesday for Election Day. I also want to let you know that on next Sunday, we will be celebrating my 3rd pastoral anniversary. Some of you might remember, praise God, thank you. There's one amen here. some of you may remember that 3 years ago, on the second Sunday in November 2017, I was installed as a pastor of the church at Clarendon. And so I am grateful for the journey that we have had together. And so if you would like to share a greeting, a well wish with me for that anniversary, you can do that via email. You have my information there, and you can also send me a card, a gift, if that's something that you would want, right here to the church. But most of all, as I ask you every Sunday, what I would appreciate is prayers. That's what I meant to say. I appreciate candy, yes, but more than that, I appreciate you praying for the pastor, praying for the church. Pray that I would grow in wisdom. Pray that I would grow in strength. Pray that I would grow in love and in patience, and in all the things that God would have in my heart, so that I will be better able to serve God first and foremost, and then to serve you, and that we might serve one another. So I'm excited. And next week, You know, it's always on Pastor's anniversary, it's always Pastor's choice regarding the music. And so next week, we're going to have some special musical guests and songs that I've selected that I love. And so you don't want to miss this time of worshiping together to celebrate my third anniversary. And thank you in advance for your kindness and for your prayers for me. Please also realize that you can join us on Sunday morning for Bible study. We have two adult classes as well as a teenage class. And so if you are not plugged in, go ahead and reach out to us so that we can get you plugged in to the adult Sunday school class. And as I mentioned last week in a very extended way, Wednesday night Bible study is also something that I really want you to plug into, if at all possible. All of these things are being done virtually. In Wednesday night Bible study, we are watching a PBS series entitled Hacking Your Mind. Last Wednesday night was a little bit intense. The information that's shared is it's gut-wrenching. It's surprising. It's fascinating. And we're learning a lot about ourselves and about one another and one another's journey and how our minds work. And so I would ask that you would keep leaning into this, and that you would keep praying and showing up, because it's so important that we learn and grow together so that we can be what we want to see in the world. We have to be the change that we want to see. And it's easy for us to realize that there are many things that need to change in our world today. And we don't want to just sit back and complain about that and talk about it. But we want to lead the charge in being the change. And that simply means being the church of Jesus Christ. And so studying and helping ourselves to learn more about God's heart and mind will allow us to be able to do that more effectively. And so please join us on Wednesday nights if you are available. And then the last thing I want to point out this morning is that we will be praying together tomorrow at 1 o'clock. We pray every Monday at 1 o'clock. In a time of intercessory prayer together. And it's very important. So if you have prayer requests, you can share that. If you can join us at 1 o'clock tomorrow via WebEx, we pray that you will do so. If you can't join us, it's okay. Just go ahead and pause wherever you are and pray with us and pray for us. And I will have a list of prayer requests and prayer needs that I know about in just a few moments. Amen. Am I speed talking? All right, I'm gonna slow down. We are transitioning into our time of giving, And I do remind you again to please get your communion elements ready. You'll be going into communion in a few moments. But thank you for your generosity and your kindness to our church. I want to thank you for the many of you who are committed to giving your tithes and your offerings. And I'm praying, and you would pray along with me, I'm asking, that more and more of us would see the benefit and the blessing to give regularly to this, your local church. And so I'm asking that you give your tithes and offering. You can do so by going to our website and clicking the giving tab. You can also use the text to give option right there on your phone. And you can also mail in your gift to us here in the church office, and we'll process it that way. Our finance team has been working diligently. It's a smaller team now than it was a year ago, but we are still processing those things. And I do also want to say just one word about end of the year giving as we get close to the end of the year. And I know sometimes you start to look at that, try to catch yourself up. You want to make sure that you have positioned yourself right for tax time. And so if you're looking to do that, please go ahead and do that sooner rather than later if possible. And especially if you're going to do something significant, like transfer stocks or do something along those lines, the sooner you do that, the better it will be, so that we will have time to coordinate with the financial institutions and make sure that those things are done by the end of the year. And we'll give you some dates that you'll know in December of when you'll need to get your last payment in or your last tithes and offering in, even if you're giving it in the mail or if you're giving it electronically. But just be mindful that those things are coming, and we are grateful for your gifts and for your generosity to God and to our church. Let us pray. God, thank you for the opportunity to give. Thank you for so many in our church and our community who are willing to show their love for you and for us through their consistent generosity in their tithe and offering. And now, God, I pray that you would bless them and continue to bless us through their gifts. Lord, we realize that these gifts go far beyond our local church, that these gifts touch families and individuals that we may never meet face to face. But you, through the power of Holy Spirit and through the various means of the partnerships that we've made both locally and nationally and internationally, you allow us, Lord, to have influence. And so please bless these gifts, bless the givers, and then give us wisdom, give us courage, give us grace to use these funds in ways that will change the world by spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ far and near. Bless us, we pray, and we say thank you in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. If you have not done so already, I hope that you will please share any prayer requests that you have. And as always, I want to ask that you would also please share your praise reports. We relish in celebrating what God is doing and what God has done in your life, in addition to praying with you and praying for you. And so as we prepare ourselves for prayer, I want to lift a few announcements or a few prayer requests to you that I know about. Please be praying for those who are grieving. We have several families in our church that have experienced grief this year, including my own family. And we have other families that have experienced grief in the last several days and weeks. Some members who've been traveling even as recently as this weekend to go to funerals, to say farewell to loved ones and to be with family. And so will you pray for those who are grieving and ask that God would give grace and peace and strength? We are going to be celebrating our holidays very soon. And I know that the holidays can be a time when you feel many emotions. We're excited, and we know that this year will be different because we might not be able to gather in the large way that we're used to. And yet the holidays are a time when we miss our loved ones who are gone on even more. So we will have our comfort circles again this year, as I have the last 2 years, and you'll hear those dates a little bit more later in the month. But just be praying for those who are grieving, and pray for yourself. And if you need, and you know that you need help processing your grief and coming through your feelings and your emotions, then please come to the Comfort Circle or reach out and take a class or look into a grief counseling support group. There's nothing wrong with that. You're getting that extra help, and being with others who are also going through that same thing will help to encourage your heart. I also want to pray for families that are separated, and we know that many can't travel to be with loved ones, and that can get a little daunting. We've been at this for so long. We thought we'd get together by Easter, then we thought we'd get together by the summer, then of course by Labor Day, Memorial Day, 4th of July, and now we're all the way almost to Thanksgiving, and we're realizing that we're still not going to be able to gather with our families. And so that separation weighs hard on us, especially if we have elderly family members or even new young family members that we aren't able to celebrate and to see for the first time. And so remember those who are separated and who need an extra sense of grace and an extra sense of connectivity. Let's pray for our seniors and for our young people. Continue to pray for our students and our families, grandparents and parents who are teaching and facilitating virtual education, our literal teachers and administrators, those who are making decisions. I know this week, I believe here in Arlington, children will start going back into the literal classroom. And so as that experience is happening, we're asking that God's peace and protection would be upon us. And I know other jurisdictions in addition will be doing that over the next several weeks. And so let's please pray for these students, pray for the teachers, pray for the facilities, pray for the bus drivers and for the lunchroom attendants and all of those people who are helping to make sure that education happens, because it's a lot of pressure and there's a lot of fear and trepidation. And so we need one another. We need to be patient and gracious and kind to one another. We need to do what the Bible says in James, and that is to be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to take offense. That's not just in regards to our educational system, but that's just in regards to all of our relationships and everything that we're experiencing right now. Holy Spirit will help us, but we have to put ourselves in position to get the strength of God so that we can operate in a way that would be pleasing, not only to God, but also affirming and loving to one another. And as always, I ask that you would please pray for our church leadership team and for our ministry partners here on campus with us. And I will pause and let you lift your quiet prayer request before the Lord. before we pray, I invite you to come and gather together with me at the communion table. We realize that this is one of the two ordinances of the church that Jesus Christ instituted before he left earth. And so as we come to this table, we come realizing that we do not stand in our own merit. We come because of the promise and the invitation of Jesus. And so will you pray with me as we bless our elements today? God, thank you for inviting us to be in communion and relationship with you. God, we realize that this is much more than simply a habitual thing that we do on First Sunday, but this represents the depth of your relationship with us, that you left this commemorating act as a way for us to remember you and to reaffirm our commitment to be unified with you and with one another. And so will you bless these elements, God, whatever we might be using today, this wafer, this cracker, this bread, this water, this juice, this wine. And will you, God, let them have not just natural significance, but spiritual significance in our lives. God, we ask for forgiveness of our sins. Forgive us of sins that we have committed, things that we have done outright, words we've said, thoughts that we have thought, behaviors that we have done that have not represented the best of you or of us. And then, God, we also pray that you forgive us for our sins of omission, the words we have neglected to say, the places we have neglected to go, the things that we have left undone, even though you have instructed us and told us to do so. God, today we come repenting. Today we come apologizing, individually and then collectively. And we ask, Lord God, that as we stand before you and one another, you might cleanse us and forgive us of all unrighteousness, as you say you'll do in your word. Bless now our coming, and let our coming, God, be more than form or fashion. Let it be salvific in nature, as we realize that this is temporary, for one day soon we will commune together with you face to face. Amen. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he was in an upper room with his disciples, and he took bread and he gave thanks for it, as I have just done, and then he broke it. And he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." I invite you, let us commune together. And likewise, he took the cup and he said, "This cup represents the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you. As often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And I invite you, let us commune together. For as often as we eat of this bread and drink of this cup, we do show forth, we prove, we commemorate, we represent the fact that Jesus came, he bled, he died, he got up, and he's coming back again to reclaim us as his church. Let us pray. God, we thank you for allowing us to commune together in this most sacred and holy way. We thank you for inviting us to be a part of your family. Thank you for those of us who have called on the name of Jesus, confessing with our mouth that Jesus is Lord, the belief that's in our heart that you're the Son of God, died for our sins and rose again. We thank you for salvation. Salvation not based on our goodness, salvation not even based on our badness, but salvation simply because of your love and your faithfulness. Jesus, it is because of your sacrifice that we are able to come not only to the communion table, but that we are able to bow in prayer today, remembering those near and far who are in need. remembering ourselves, God, and our church. We're praying for our world today. We're praying for our nation, asking God that you would heal us, that you would help us, God, to overcome and to endure and to fight through the chaos, the contention, the pain, and the sadness that so many are feeling. God, so many are tense and anxious about the coming election, and rightfully so. For we have seen, possibly in the last 4 years, but especially in the last 8 months, the very worst of humanity right around us. And yet, God, I'm grateful to report today that not only have we seen the worst, but in the midst of this pandemic, we have been reminded of the best that is among us, that people are still generous and kind and loving, that we have cultivated new friendships and strengthened old ones, even through virtual means. And so, God, we will not give up hope. We will not let the report of the enemy, the report of the media, be the report that we believe. But today, we believe the report of the Lord. We believe, God, that you are the everlasting God, that you are high and mighty, that you are lifted up, and we want to see your glory fill the temple of our hearts, the temple of our homes, the temple of our lives, the temple of the earth, and even the entire universe. So God, as we go into this week, will you give us grace? Will you give us peace and wisdom? Will you protect us from ourselves and protect us from the evil that's in the land? Those who might be plotting evil, who might not want to respond the way that they should, will you seal their hands in the name of Jesus? We bind the enemy and declare that you have no power or authority, but we, the church, step into our rightful place and we claim and we proclaim the truth of Jesus. We loose peace. We loose power. We lose friendship and grace and goodness everywhere we go. And we will think about what's true and honest and just and pure and lovely. And we will speak such so that we can experience such in our lives. God, will you be with those who are grieving, those who are separated from loved ones and friends? Will you be with those who are in need of a job, those who are suffering with not enough food and inadequate shelter? Will you be with our families and schools that are going back to school on campus this week and in the following days and weeks? We need your help, oh God. We need your help, oh God. Father, we stretch our hand to thee. There is no other help we know. And we believe you will hear us and you will help us. So we end this prayer with these words: praise to the Lord, the Almighty. Amen and amen.
Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise Him, He is thy help and salvation. All ye who hear, now to His temple draw near, joining in glad adoration. Praise to the Lord, who of all things so wondrously created, shelters thee under His wings and so gently sustained. Had thou not seen how all thy homies have been granted Him what He ordained? Praise to the Lord, who doth prosper thy work and defend thee. Surely his goodness and mercy shall ever attend me. I never knew what the Almighty can do. With his love he befriend me.
That says, ponder anew what the Almighty will do if with his love he befriend thee. Woo! Ponder anew. You might know the Lord's love, but just take a minute and reflect anew again on the love of God in your life. How about you? That gets me happy. Hallelujah. That's good. Yeah.
Oh, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. God, we praise you. We thank you for your word. We thank you for illuminating our minds, our hearts, and our spirits. As we approach these moments of preaching and teaching, Lord, have thine own way, we pray. Speak what you know needs to be spoken. To give us the words of life. For if you don't speak, God, all of this will be for nothing. But we know you love us too much to leave us needing what you will not provide. So we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. Hallelujah. Will you praise God with me for our worship team? Hallelujah. And our multimedia ministry this morning. I'm so grateful to see their smiling faces. I've probably seen y'all more than I've seen my own family in the last 8 months. So I guess we're family now. And that means I will be expecting birthday gifts. Ha! Amen, amen. Well, this morning we are going to end our journey in this sermon series that we have been dealing with for the last 7 weeks entitled Free Your Mind. I was speaking to one of our members this morning. He said, is the title Free Your Mind Part 7? I said, that's it. We started this sermon series way back in September. And I'll be honest with you, at the time, I had no idea it was going to go this many weeks. Some of my friends know I wanted to get to this Philippians chapter 4 text probably at least 3 weeks ago. God kept showing me that I needed to lay a different foundation because we can't talk about what to think about until we understand what we need to be free from. And that's a lesson for us today, maybe in other areas of our lives, that you're trying to change behavior. You're trying to make choices and decisions externally, but you haven't done the internal work yet. You can't stop doing until you stop thinking and speaking a certain way. And so this morning, as we come to this text in Philippians chapter 4, I invite you to please be open to Holy Spirit. And if you are coming in at the end of it, don't fear. All of the videos and all the audios of the 6 previous sermons are available for you. And I believe it will be edifying to your life to come through and to remind yourself and maybe even listen to those sermons again, because God is and has been speaking to us. This morning, we are in Philippians chapter 4. Again, I will begin my reading at verse 4 and go down through verse 9. Philippians 4 and 4 from the NIV. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again. Rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, verse 6 says, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. Lord, let the words of my mouth and the collective meditation of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight. For you alone are our strength, our wisdom, and our Redeemer. Speak, O Lord. Amen. You may be seated. Free your mind. Free your mind. I have, in the last almost 3 years, preached a lot of sermons. And not that I'm counting or anything, but the Sundays come very quickly. But I will say that this sermon series is one that sticks out in my mind, because I have heard from more of you than I have about this series in a while. It was the same way when we talked about the names of God. That was a series that a lot of people really felt a lot about. And of course, the sermon about don't be afraid to die. That was a hot one that a lot of people talked about. But this Free Your Mind sermon series has caused a lot of you to ponder and to think and become alert and aware to what's going on within you and what's going on around you. And I believe that that was what God intended. I'll tell you how I got the title to this sermon series. Back in September, I was riding in the car and my brother and I were listening to some 90s music. Some of y'all weren't born in the 90s, but that's okay. And back then, there was a song by a female group entitled In Vogue that was called Free Your Mind. And In Vogue said, you know, free your mind and the rest will follow. Come on in here now. Free your mind. Don't you be so shallow. Free your mind and the rest will follow. And while that's not gospel, what In Vogue was saying is nonetheless true. If we get our minds free, the rest of our life, the rest of our existence, if we get our relationship with God right, the rest of our relationships will follow suit. But if you're walking around with a mind that's bound and cluttered, it will be very hard for you to live a free life. Free your mind. Don't let the world squeeze you in, but you let the Lord transform you and change you from within. So the premise for this sermon series has been simple, that God wants us to live liberated and free from everything that would bind and hinder us from fully knowing, loving, and living like Christ. You say, I've heard that before. Indeed, you have. It's one sermon in seven different parts, and that's the only thing I've been preaching about, that God wants us to be free. And in John 8 and 36, we are reminded that the Son of God, Jesus, is the one who will make us free. So you and I, we have work to do, but the ultimate work is going to be done by Jesus through the power of Holy Spirit to free us, for the one whom the Son sets free is truly free indeed. God wants you to be free. And so as we've walked through this over these last 6 weeks, I have tried to convince you that when your mind is free, you can be transformed and you can then be set on the right thoughts by the power of Holy Spirit. Once you get a free mind, then it can be transformed and set on the right thoughts. Once you realize what thoughts are not good, the things that you need to cast down and throw away, then there will be room and you will have the energy and the alertness to allow Holy Spirit to transform your mind and to set your mind on the right things. And that's what I was saying about this Philippians passage. I wanted to get to that part that said, think on these things. But Holy Spirit kept saying to me, wait, be patient. You have to do the work. As some of you who are gardeners might understand that. You can't just go out there and plant seeds. But you have to till the soil. You have to get it fertilized. You have to break up the fallow ground and the hardness so that when the seed goes in, it will have good soil to come into. And we'll come back to that planting analogy at the end of the sermon. But when your mind is free, then it can be transformed and set on the right things by power of Holy Spirit. And so we need the mind of Christ. And what I've been trying to get you to understand and agree with me about is simply this. This is why this is so important. Free your mind and the rest will follow. You and I must set the tone of our minds because the tone of our mind sets the tone for our life. If your mind is off, everything else you do is going to be off. If your thinking is sinking, you're not going to be able to have freshness in your relationships. There won't be good things and positivity flowing in your heart and coming out of your mouth because your thinking dictates everything else. And so as we shared just a couple of weeks ago, when we first started looking at this Philippians 4 passage, there is a cycle, if you will, a process about how our minds can be free and how our minds operate when they are free. And it's right there in the passage which I've read for you in Philippians chapter 4. You can go back to, I believe, sermon 5 to hear the sermon where I talked about this in depthly. But here, Paul is telling us that we have to rejoice. And so the tone of our mind has to be one of joyfulness. And joyfulness will lead us into this sense of being mindful of others, that we don't live for ourselves, and that what we do doesn't just impact us. This is where the rubber really meets the road, because if it was just me and my life and my mind, maybe I could stay in a broken state. But I don't just impact me. I impact you and my neighbors and my friends and those who know and love me. And even those who don't know me are impacted by me because of the position I hold. And so it's so important that we remain mindful of others and get free. But then also mindfulness will lead us into this understanding that we should be prayerful. It's right there in the text that in every situation, we should be prayerful, taking our requests to God. And I want to tell someone today, because you're having some trouble thinking that God wants to hear from you. You think, I've gone to God too many times about this. Why can't I get it right? God is tired of hearing from me. No, that's a lie. Just like the Bible says, you can present your requests to God over and over again, whatever they may be. God wants you to be prayerful and to come to God with your needs and with your concerns. So don't let the enemy tell you that you can't pray, that you have to stop praying. Because if you can't talk to God, my friends, who can you talk to? Prayerfulness leads us into a sense of gratitude and gratefulness. This is the tone of our mind I'm talking about. And when you have a free mind, you will understand that gratitude can never be too far from your thinking. Because even as we started off this morning with our hymn of the month, no matter what we're going through and where we are, there is always something in which and for which to be grateful. And the Bible says that when we rejoice and are mindful of others, we're prayerful and we're grateful, then God will, the God of peace, will give us peace to guard our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. And so this is the foundation of what we need. And then once we have this tone of going on in our minds and this cycle is being exercised and it's firing on all cylinders, then we can set about the work of allowing the actual thoughts of our mind to be set and to be monitored. And this is where we pick up in Philippians 4:8, where the Bible simply says, finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Last week, I went through the first four in this series about true, honorable, just, and pure, and you can go back and hear that sermon if you missed it. And so this morning, let me go through the last four of these eight mindsets that the Bible tells us we should be thinking about constantly. I'm picking up here with number five, which is simply this: lovely. Lovely. Brothers and sisters, think about whatever is lovely. This idea of lovely, when you look it up in the Greek, literally has to do with it being pleasing and acceptable. And I like this idea, friendly towards. So it's letting us know that God wants us dwelling on things that are acceptable and pleasing. God doesn't want us thinking about the worst. God doesn't want you even dwelling on what your enemies might be saying and doing. But God wants you thinking thoughts that are friendly about God, about yourself, and about one another. Literally, what this is suggesting to us is that God wants us to dwell on love. The love chapter in the Bible is found in 1 Corinthians 13. And this is what verses 4-7 in the New Living Translation says. And this is what we should be thinking about when we say we're thinking about things that are lovely. Love is patient and kind. Love is not jealous or boastful or proud or rude. It does not demand its own way. It is not irritable. Did y'all see that? It is not irritable. So, y'all know some irritable people? Y'all saying, move on, Pastor Danielle. Okay. It is not irritable, and it keeps no record of being wronged. It does not rejoice about injustice, but rejoices whenever the truth wins out. Love never gives up. Love never loses faith, is always hopeful, and endures through every circumstance. When the Bible tells us to think about things that are lovely, this is what the Bible is talking about, that you have to be aware and accept the reality in which you're living, but you can't allow the reality and the facts of your life to be more important than the truth of God's word. Yes, you have to deal with the reality, but don't forget to live in truth. Deal with the reality, but live in truth. Ponder the truth, dwell on the truth, and the truth is God has thought friendly thoughts about us, and we should be thinking friendly thoughts towards God, towards ourselves, and towards others. Paul says, think on these things. This is what your mind should be set on, things that are lovely. But also here, not only that, sixthly, is also things that are of a good report. Literally, this is suggesting to us that we are dwelling on things that are admirable and commendable and things that would remind us of well-speaking. You know how your grandma probably told you, or maybe your mama said, if you don't have anything good to say, don't say anything at all. Well, here's the thing. You're never going to have anything good to say about someone if you don't think good thoughts about them. If you don't give yourself a good report about yourself, then you're not going to feel good about yourself. And so sometimes we have to say to ourselves, you know what, self? You're looking good today, girl, or whatever you say to yourself. You have to have a good report and report about things that are commendable and that are admirable. So literally, what we're looking at here is in Philippians chapter 1, verses 3 through 4a. And I told you to read through all the book of Philippians. This is what Paul said. Every time I think of you, I give thanks to God, my Father. Whenever I pray, I make my requests for all of you with joy. This should be the true tone of our hearts, that we should be able to report that every time I think about the members of the church at Clarendon, I thank God for you. I say thank you, Lord, for sending me to this church 3 years ago. I say thank you, God, for giving me generous members and friends to walk alongside. Every time you think about that neighbor that has that dog that barks in the middle of the night, you should think good things about them. Not I wish that that mutt would shut. Okay, all right, I'm sorry. I live next to a dog park. Is that just me? All right, forgive me. Pray for the pastor. But we have to choose to have a good report and to think about the good things of people. And this is where this comes into play, really. When you walk with people long enough, you're going to see some of their uncomely, disappointing parts. And what this is literally saying to me is that even when I learn things about you that are not admirable, I won't judge you based on those uncomely things. I'll judge you based on what's commendable about you. Because Jesus gives God a good report about us, even when we fail. The Bible tells us that Jesus is advocating for us at the right hand of the Father. And so when we fall, Jesus goes in and says, yeah, but remember, she prayed last week. Remember, she's been trying to get it right. She's been reading her Bible. He's been doing better. He's been really focused on you. So, yes, he stumbled, but we died for that. My grace is sufficient. That's the report God is getting on our behalf. And that's the report that we should be dwelling on when we are thinking these kinds of thoughts. We should be thinking good report thoughts. It reminds me of one of my favorite movies, The Wiz, which is an African-American version of The Wizard of Oz. And there was this one good scene where one of the evil witches said, look, don't nobody bring me no bad news. And sometimes that's what you got to say to yourself. I don't want to hear no bad news. I want good reports. And that's what I want to dwell on. But not only does the Bible say we have to think about whatever is lovely and whatever is of good report, but also, seventhly, whatever is excellent. Whatever is excellent. If there be any excellence or virtue, think on these things. This literally has to do with valor. It talked about this manliness of having this valor, being a soldier, being someone who's a great reputation, personal bravery, and moral. It literally talked about moral excellence. And so we want to be thinking and dwelling on things that are morally excellent and virtuous. And so this gets back to what I was talking about last week a little bit when I talked about purity, that we can't set things that are immoral before our eyes and then think we're going to be able to live virtuous moral lives. We can't set things that are immoral before our ears and think that we're going to be able to hear clearly from the Lord and not be cluttered in our thinking. No, the Bible says think on things that are excellent, things that are of excellence and that are moral. And so this is what it says in 2 Peter 1, 3, and then 5 through 7. This is a promise from the Lord. As his divine power, God's power, has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness. We already have it. Through the knowledge of him who called us by glory and virtue. Literally saying that when we were called by virtue to be virtuous. But also, for this very reason, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue, knowledge. To knowledge, self-control. To self-control, perseverance. To perseverance, godliness. To godliness, brotherly kindness. And to brotherly kindness, love. This process lets us know that we can't simply have faith. It's good to be a person of faith, but if you're going to make it in this world, you need more than faith. You have to add to it. And the second thing that the Bible tells us to add to our faith is virtue. That we would be people who are brave and moral and live with a high standard of valor and excellence. That's what we want to think about, so that that's what we will speak about, so that that would be how we live. And then lastly, in this list of things that are setting the tone for our mind, what we're thinking about, not only things that are of good report and excellent and praise, but lastly, things that are praiseworthy. I like the Bible because it just says this: if there is anything that you can praise God about, think about that. Whatever is praiseworthy, think about that. You stumped your toe, but at least you got a toe. Praise God. You might not have as many hours as you had at the job, but you're still employed. Praise God. You might not be eating the steak and the lobster that you were eating, but at least you're not hungry. Praise God. If there's anything praiseworthy, think about this. And so I was reminded about Ephesians 1. Ephesians 1, 3 and 6 starts by saying, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. If you can't praise God for anything else, you can just praise God that God is the Father of Jesus, and Jesus came and lived and died and rose again for us. And so we are blessed. And then when you get down to the bottom of first Ephesians 1 and 6, it says this: according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise and glory of his grace, by which he has made us acceptable in the beloved, that we can praise God because of who Jesus is and what Jesus has done. And no matter what, friends, we have to be thinking on thoughts of praise. Even when the sun is not shining, we have to be thanking God for the rain, because the rain serves an important purpose. Even when we're walking through a difficult season in our life, at least we can say, praise God that the person is still walking with me and they haven't walked away from me. Even when challenges are going on in our bodies and we might have a hard time dealing with illnesses and things like that, at least we can say, I have a doctor. I have health care. I can get some help. Find something to praise God about and think on these things. When the Bible says think on these things, it literally means center your mind on these thoughts and implant them into your heart. I'm almost finished, but this is what I told you at the beginning about getting back to this planting analogy, that literally what we dwell on seeps into our heart and starts to bring back a harvest and germinates, and something will bloom up. And so if you want to see something bloom that's good, you have to dwell on good seeds and plant good seeds in your heart. You have to center your mind on these things. Whatsoever is true, honest, just, pure, lovely, of good report, virtuous, and praiseworthy. Think on these things. Center your mind on them. And then as you center your mind on them, they will be implanted into your heart. And if you implant it in your heart, guess what? It will bring you back a great concern, a great reward. How do you plant things in your heart? Plant it there through confession. Plant it through conviction. Plant things in your heart through conversation with others. And plant things in your heart through simply remaining committed, building the habit around it. Confess your beliefs. Stand on your convictions. Talk to others about it. And remain committed even when it's difficult. Because then if you plant those seeds, you will bring back a great harvest. Whenever you have an opportunity, do good to everyone, especially to those who are in the household of faith. This is where we want to get, friends, that we want God to not only change our minds, we want that, but we really want God to change our words, we want that. But ultimately, the reason we want to be free is so that God would change our hearts. Because if God changes our hearts, that's the place from which we live. That's the place from which everything else flows. And it gets into our heart through our mind. And so when God changes our thinking and changes our speaking and changes our living, our hearts will be new. And then we can live free lives that will honor God and will declare God's goodness everywhere we go, even in our own lives. Hallelujah.
Change my heart, oh God. Make it ever true.
Change my heart, oh God. May I be like you.
Yeah, hallelujah.
Change my heart, oh God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God. May I be like you. You are the Potter.
That's it.
I am the clay. Hold me and make me.
Hallelujah.
This is what I pray. Change my heart, oh God.
Can you sing that with the praise team today?
Make it ever true.
Is that your confession? Is that your understanding?
Change my heart, oh God.
Is that your desire today?
May I be
that you would have a heart that's like God's hearts.
Change my heart, oh God.
This is a simple prayer. I wish you would just lift it wherever you are right now.
Make it ever true.
Yeah. Say it with me. I'll sing too.
Change my heart, oh God. May I be like you.
Here's the truth. You are the potter.
You are the Father.
We don't make ourselves, friends.
I am.
God makes us. God fashions us. God knows our final state. God has an image in God's minds about how we're going to look and be. We can trust God to fashion us and mold us and make us. But it doesn't start on the outside. It starts with our hearts. And our heart gets changed when our mind gets convinced that God's ways are higher and better than our ways.
Change my heart, oh God.
Oh God, won't you make me more like you?
May I be like you.
Our prayer of salvation, I'll ask you to lift with me, because all of that we've been preaching and teaching about, a changed heart, doesn't happen unless you're in relationship with God. And so will you lift these words perhaps for the first time? If you realize you can't save yourself, but you need God. And if you're already in relationship with God, then won't you just affirm your faith today? Dear God, I believe that your son Jesus died on the cross for me and rose from the dead. Help me with any part of me that does not believe. I confess that I have made mistakes and I ask for your forgiveness. I invite Jesus into my life to be my personal Lord and Savior. Thank you for my salvation. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. If you prayed that prayer with us for the first time, won't you tell us so that we can get you baptized and get you connected to a church? If you want to join our church, tell us that. We'll get you that information. And if you are simply affirming your faith, go in the power of knowing that if God changes your heart, your whole life will follow. Free your mind, and the rest will follow. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Amen. Well, thank you for journeying with us for this last 7 weeks as we've gone through this sermon series. Please continue to review these principles, and we'll still be talking about this in Wednesday night Bible study for the next several weeks. As we prepare to go, I will ask that you would lift our spoken benediction as we go. I want to remind you that I will be here between 2 and 3 o'clock to receive any of your cards and gifts for staff and leadership appreciation. And I hope that you'll be praying with us tomorrow afternoon at 1 o'clock. Be safe as you go to the polls this week. Let's lift our spoken benediction as we go. As we go, we confess that Jesus is Lord. We affirm our faith in God's word. We are thankful for God's love. We agree to act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly, for this is what God requires. May the Lord bless you, and may the Lord keep you. May the Lord smile on you, on your circumstances, on your relationships, and give you great peace. This week, free your mind. Make a decision to dwell on whatever is true, honorable, just, pure, lovely, pleasing. If there be any excellence, any virtue, or any praise, think on these things. And God will not only change your mind, God will change your heart and your life. Amen. I love you. Have a wonderful week in the Lord. We'll see you back real soon. God bless you.
You are the everlasting God. To lift us up on wings like eagles. Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Bless your name, Jesus. Hallelujah.